Welcome to Forum at 360. I'm Andrew Kitchenman. Today on Forum at 360, we're talking about Alaska politics. From the state's geography and demographics to its reliance on the oil and gas industry, Alaska is a unique state. It's also a state with many contradictions. Alaskans love their independence, but Alaska's economy also relies on federal and state spending. And state politics have also changed dramatically over the past few decades. Clive Thomas has studied Alaska politics for 35 years, since he joined the political science faculty at the University of Alaska Southeast. He recently completed editing Alaska Politics and Public Policy, a 1,200-page book on the history and practice of Alaska politics, published by the University of Alaska Press. So, Clive, how did you come to write Alaska Politics and Public Policy?
Well, Andrew, and I appreciate being here, by the way. Very, very kind of you to invite me. I taught at UAS for 30 years, and all that time, for 25 years, I taught Alaska politics. And I'd written quite a bit on Alaska politics. Before then, I published a book in 1999 on issues in Alaska politics, and I'd done other articles and chapters and books, you know, for national books that cover state politics. And in 2009, a couple of my friends, faculty members, one in Fairbanks and one in Anchorage, UAF and UAA, said, why don't we do an updated book? And so basically, that's where it started. I ended up, it's an edited book, as you know, ended up recruiting 67 people to contribute towards this book, many of whom are well-known politicians, some current, some from the past. It was basically intended as a book that could be used by almost all Alaskans. The way I got recruited, when I decided that I was interested in doing it, I talked to the University of Alaska Press, which was the obvious press to do this book. And the then director said he was interested in doing it, but it would have to be a book that appealed to everybody from high school students through to graduate students, and also would be readable by the general public. So this was quite a challenge for me to do this, and and maybe we can talk about this later, the book is structured in a way that it can be useful for high school students, and particularly social studies teachers who, you know, teach high school students, and also undergraduates and graduates, and also hopefully the general public, you know, various members of the general public, government officials, or just the average person who wants to find out more about Alaska politics, basically. Yeah, so that's how I came to do it, and it's been, herding 67 cats is not an easy thing to do, you know.
So what's in the book?
Well, it's by far the most comprehensive book ever written on Alaska politics. It's got 30 chapters, and that's why it's 1,200 pages long, of course. It's divided into sections, and it looks, first of all, at some general basic background on Alaska politics. And the whole book is built around 12, what I call 12 characteristics of Alaska politics, such as fiscal conservatism, the role of Alaska Natives, weak political parties and strong interest groups, three contending branches of government, and there are other ones as well that I won't go into now. And so the book is built around those, and then there's an introductory section, and then there's a section on the influences on Alaska politics, such as the economy, state constitution, the role of Alaska Natives, intergovernmental relations and the role of the federal government, of course very controversial in Alaska. And then the next section looks at institutions, governor, interest groups, the role of the courts, the budget, and then there's a section on natural resources, and then there's a final section on social services, which looks at education, corrections and health, and then the last chapter in that section is on transportation. Then there's a final section that looks at, you know, possible future developments in the state. So it covers a lot of stuff, a lot of material, and it's, you know, very useful, I think, to people. Somebody, say, for example, who wants to find out about fisheries and doesn't know anything about fisheries, a well-known person in the state, Bob King, who was actually Governor Knowles' press secretary and has been a aficionado on fish for many, many years. He wrote that chapter, and so, you know, that's a very self-contained chapter that people could find out about fisheries. There's one on oil and gas, one on the, quite an extensive one on the permanent fund, and so on. So basically, that's who it's for, and hopefully those people will read it.
So there are a lot of examples of how Alaska politics works in the book. Many of them are included in the boxes that are sort of interspersed throughout the chapters. Could you tell us a little bit about what you were looking to do with that?
To make it a reader-friendly book, you know, it's written, I think, in a very readable style, but we wanted to make, or I ended up doing it. My two friends who supported wanted me to do it. They long since disappeared, so I was left with the book, which is fun. I had a wonderful time doing it. I wanted to have some people who are practitioners, you know, to illustrate some of the points we made. So the boxes include some practitioners writing about things. For example, Tony Knowles, former Governor Knowles, wrote an insert on Alaska's relations with Canada. He wrote one on the role of the federal government. Wendy Chamberlain, who many people may know, a well-known lobbyist in Alaska, she wrote one on being a lobbyist, and now she became a lobbyist. Dave Donaldson, who many people will remember, is the political reporter here in Juneau for a long time. He wrote one on, you know, being a journalist and you know, how that affects policy and so on, or doesn't affect policy, as he argues in the end. So those things. There's also some boxes, for example, that sort of define some terms. Like, for example, in Bob King's chapter about fisheries, there's so many different fishery terms. There's a little box that defines those terms, and Bob makes them very clear and succinct. So those things. And then there's other boxes that look at issues, like, for example, Tim Bradner, who many people may know, does a newsletter with his brother Mike. He did a very good insert on the continuing issue of the gas pipeline and various other things. So that's what the boxes are, and they're meant to be that way, succinct, and to sort of illustrate many of the points in the chapters, basically, yes.
You use terms that are unique to Alaska politics. There are also some terms that may have been invented in political science. One phrase you use is pragmatic dependent individualism. Yeah. And you use that to describe Alaskan politics. What do you mean by that?
Well, it is a mouthful, I must admit. It is a big mouthful. But basically, it boils down to this. In fact, of the 12 characteristics of Alaska politics, that's the first one we identify. And this is how it breaks down. Okay. First of all, a lot of Alaskans see themselves as independent, you know. And I think that's the image of Alaska down south, you know, on the outside, we might say. Who believe that, you know, Alaskans are fighting the wilderness and so on, and there are these independent people who come up to Alaska. And, you know, there's this image. And some Alaskans, I believe that too. But of course, even in the days of the, you know, the gold rush and those sorts of things, they weren't independent to an extent that they survived on their own. And today, and really since the 1970s, and really since statehood, you know, government has been a major driver, and of course eventually oil became a major driver. And so really people are dependent on the state and dependent upon government. So these two terms, which sound very contradictory, dependent individualism, meld together because people still believe they're independent to a certain extent, but they're dependent. And a lot of people would deny this. I mean, I've interviewed a lot of people over the years in Alaska. Yeah, but at the same time, people are very pragmatic about it. And, you know, they may deny this in some ways, but they actually work out a way to handle it. And I think this is true of a lot of legislators, and I think it's true of a lot of you know, politicians generally. And so it's this kind of complicated individualism with dependence and also, you know, this sort of pragmatism. And I think you see that. You see it particularly with the Republicans who talk about cutting the budget, and of course they want to get money for their districts, and so they can sort of, you know, they become very pragmatic and so on, and that's, I think that's sort of the essence of that phrase.
Regarding pragmatic dependent individualism, if the price of oil or oil production were to stay low, do you think that something would have to give, that either Alaskan's sense of dependence or individualism would change?
Well, it's a good question. I think that I'd answer it this way. I think that if oil stays where it is now, and the state has less revenue, I think that people would have to come to accept that they would need to use the permanent fund in some way to level out revenues and, you know, to keep the economy buoyant, which it can't be if revenues stay down and so on. So I think in that regard, Alaskans would become more dependent, I guess, on the fund. And in terms of their independence, I don't think it would make that much difference as it was before. But it would show more pragmatism that they were willing to use the fund to get over, you know, what is a major hump in the state's economic health, you might say. So I think that in that regard, pragmatism would come into play, I think. But the question is, how do you get to that stage after the last session? It's a good question how that would happen. But I think that probably ultimately they're going to have to do something. And so I guess you could say it would be a pragmatic way, but it has to be, I think, the permanent fund is probably the only way to go.
Now, your academic research has focused on lobbying and interest groups over time. How has it changed in Alaska?
Well, I think a couple of things. I think that the operation of interest groups and lobbyists has become more professional, I think. In what we might call the old days, that is to say, when I came here in 1980, a lot of business was done, not in the legislature, but down in the Baranoff Hotel, down the hill. This was the old Baranoff. The old Baranoff burned, I think, 1984. Someone got angry or something, an ex-employee, and he set light to the Baranoff. But before that time, there was a room in the Baranoff called the Bubble Room, and it had lots of tables, round tables, and prominent legislators, a guy called Don Bennett, another legislator from Ketchikan, and several others, they would have tables there, and people would do their business down there, lobbyists would come down there, and there were quite a few good old boy lobbyists, those people, they would do business, and a lot of it was behind closed doors. Once the Baranoff burned, for some reason, it seemed to be kind of a sort of a turning point, and also transparency, Alaska Public Offices Commission rules changed, and things became more transparent. Less legislators went out less often. Lobbyists became more professional in terms of dealing with legislators more upfront, and so on. So I think that's happened. They became more professional. In terms of the organizations, the lobbying groups themselves, the number of groups I think has expanded because of more people being involved in politics, in organizations, I guess several of them, Right to Life, the Outdoor Council, those groups became more active and so on. And the groups that have been around for years, they're in the early 80s and the late 70s, and I've done quite a bit of research on the time sequence of influence and power over the 30 years from 1980 to 2010. In the early 80s, the oil companies, of course, were influential as they are now. And it used to be that National Educational Association, the teachers, and the Association of Alaska School Boards. That has not changed very much, even in today. Teachers took a sort of a nosedive in the mid-90s, mainly because there was a sort of an anti-union movement in the United States, and that affected a lot of unions. Today, the School Boards Association and the oil companies, I think, are still most influential of all groups. Though, they don't always win. They lose sometimes, but in terms of that. That is not typical in the United States as a whole. We're looking at the most influential groups over the last 30 years. The top two groups would be Chambers of Commerce, and it would be teachers, NEA, and also sometimes AFT, the American Federation of Teachers. That is quite different in Alaska, largely because I think the economy is quite different. You don't have manufacturing and so on. So government is a major factor here, okay? The other thing I would say, which a lot of people don't, I think about or realize, is that some of the most influential groups in Alaska are government groups. You know, Alaska's a government state in many ways, and government is very significant. And for example, I'll give you two good examples. The court system. You would never think of the court system as being a lobbying organization, but in fact, you know, the court system has to fight for its budget and so on. And back in the 70s and 80s and up until 97, they had a court director. His name was Art Snowden. And he was probably one of the most effective lobbyists this state has ever seen, though he wasn't called a lobbyist. He didn't have to register with the Alaska Public Offices Commission, but he was very successful. He got very good retirement for judges and actually for himself too. He got a new courthouse in Anchorage on Fourth Avenue. And generally speaking, the court system did very, very well. And you know, I don't know what else you'd call that, but lobbying. So he was very successful. The University of Alaska is another example. People don't think of the University of Alaska as a lobbying group or an organization. They think of it as a state agency. Well, I don't know if it's an agency, but it's a part of the state. Obviously, it's part of the state government in some way. The University of Alaska has been very successful in protecting itself and you know, lobbying for programs and so on, at least until the, you know, the downturn in oil prices most recently. And it had a couple of people who were lobbyists. One of the most prominent ones for many years was a lady called Wendy Redmond. And she'd come down here and she'd, you know, she'd fight for, you know, research money for UAF and a new building for UAA and some stuff for here. And the university was very successful, and they were particularly successful under President Mark Hamilton between 1998 and I think he retired in 2010. And a lot of that was not so much to do with Hamilton, though he was an extremely effective and very charismatic person, but because oil revenues were up. But so that's, I think, what I would look at the changes. But government is still a very important lobbyist in the state, and you know, as I say, the Association of Alaska School Boards and the oil industry too.
Earlier you said that political parties in Alaska are weak.
Yeah.
If that's, why do you think that's true? And if it is, what causes that?
Well, I think that, you know, what do we mean by weak political parties? Well, it means that they can't control necessarily who runs as a Democrat or a Republican. And then once elected, they don't really have the discipline to be able to force their members to vote in a certain way. And so they tend to be weak in that regard. Now, that you shouldn't confuse that with the caucus, with the Senate and House caucuses. Because the caucuses, although they tend to be, at least recently since the late 90s, they tend to be Republicans, the caucus is kind of a different thing. But it's not like a party that would come into power and have a whole program that they would be able to implement. And Alaska's never really had that, even when the Democrats sort of not dominated the state, but they were in the majority really until the early 90s. And so we would call them weak because they, you know, they don't have a platform that they could implement. Now, if you go back east, if you go to New Jersey or you go to Massachusetts, then parties are much stronger there, and they can really control things. They can control the public policy process. The parties here can't do that. But, as we said, the caucuses can. And the difference is that the caucus comes together and usually around two issues, and one basic issue. And that basic issue is, if you join this caucus, you must support the budget. You must support the budget. You can't break ranks on the budget. And another one sometimes is they've got to follow the dictates of the or the decisions of the President of the Senate or the Speaker of the House. And those people who do in fact butt the budget party get kicked out, you know, like Reinwald did 2 years ago. So I think that's what we talk about when we're talking about weak parties. Why are they weak? Well, I think a couple of things. And this is common in the Western states, by the way, Idaho, you know, Utah and so on, although those states are dominated by Republicans. I think the answer is friends and neighbors politics. This is a very small state. I mean, small state physically, but it's a small state population-wise. There's only, I think, 740,000 people here you know, the projections are for 2016. And, you know, not everybody knows everybody else, but, I mean, I was once told by a legislator, I don't remember who it was, that Alaska's the biggest, smallest little state in the world. You know, it's kind of like a village, you know, where you know, I was brought up in a village in England, and everybody knew everybody else, and they also knew everybody else's business. And I think in Alaska, you know, there's a lot of friends and neighbors politics. Even in Anchorage, you know, which is by far the biggest city, as you know, a legislator can probably walk around his district, at least a House member, but even a Senate member can do that. And they can meet people. They can't meet everyone, but it's kind of a local thing and so on. And there's not that distance that you would get in California, for example. You know, one senator in California, state senator we're talking about now, represents about 560,000 people, which is not much less than the whole state of Alaska's population. And of course, they can never meet everybody or even, you know, 1/100th of the people there. And so, you know, what happens there is you have much more, you know, media campaigning and so on in Alaska. There, that happens, particularly in governor's races. And of course, in US Senate races, quite different. But I think that the friends and neighbors nature, particularly in the bush, I mean, the bush is very much that way. In fact, Mary Sattler was, you know, once Mary Nelson as a legislator, she wrote an article, one of the inserts in that book, one of the boxes, about the ideal of campaigning in the bush. You're campaigning often with your, you know, the people who are related and so on, and it's a very different way of dealing with things. So I think that's probably one of the major reasons is the friends and neighbors politics element of the state.
Now, Bush Democrats have caucused with the majority caucus for the last several years and off and on for the past several decades, regardless of which party controlled the majority. And I was interested in your perspective on why you think that's occurred and if that's changing.
Well, I think it occurs for a very simple reason, and that is that, you know, the Bush still has, you know, we have two Alaskas, really. We have urban Alaska and we have Bush Alaska in terms of, you know, facilities. You know, up to 20 or 30 years ago, and still true, you know, there's not a lot of pipe water in the bush, you know, sanitation and so on. People used honey buckets and the rest of it. So the bush needs a lot of capital projects. You know, they need, you know, fire stations, they need basic sewer and water, they need, you know, airstrips that are kept, you know, clear of snow or extended and so on. And so Bush Democrats really have a lot of pressure on them to get capital money. And so, you know, one of the things they do is they go with that group who can provide it for them. And, you know, ideology in the bush is very fluid. I mean, you know, in fact, it's generally fluid in Alaska, except for the very right and the very left. And so, you know, their particular purpose is very pragmatic. You know, we got a bit of pragmatism here. They will join the majority caucus because, as Reggie Jewell once said, you know, on your report on that, which was a very good report, is that, you know, he was fed up with throwing stones from the outside. He'd like to get in the tent because in the tent he could have much more influence. And that, I think, sums up what happens. You know, if you get inside there, you'll get some of the capital money because you support the caucus. And of course, there have been several people that have been masters at this. Back in the 80s, some people probably don't remember, but some people will, a guy called John Sackett, who was from Ruby, and he was an expert at doing this. He would always be in the majority, whether it was Democrats or Republicans and so on. And of course, Lyman Hoffman's that, like that now. You know, he's always been in the majority and so on, whether it's Democrat or Republicans. And so I think they do that because, you know, they want to get capital money, and of course, that's what's going to get you elected. Whereas if you're an urban legislator, you know, say an Anchorage legislator, and the project comes up, it probably goes across two or three districts or, you know, House districts or maybe two or three Senate districts, you know, like a road project or something, or should we say a new state office building or something. And so of course, every legislator claims that they got the money for that. But of course, if they didn't get the money, they can blame somebody else because, you know, they're not the one responsible directly. See, that can't happen in the bush because, you know, it can't happen. So I think that's why they do it. Is it changing recently? Well, it might be for this reason. there's no capital money left now. I mean, at least there hasn't been in the last couple of years. Most of the capital money is gone to as federal matching funds for things like transportation and so on, and there just isn't any capital money left. And so, you know, really, what would be the advantage of, you know, a Bush Democrat joining a majority Republican caucus? On the other hand, I think the Democrats have also realized that, you know, they can now go after the Democrats who joined the majority. And of course, they were very successful in two people, at least one, you know, with Bob Perrin and also with Nick Abbott. It seems to appear that way. So I think that it may be changing a little bit. And also because probably the Democrats, who at least in the House, who've been out in the cold for pretty close to 25 years now, probably want to get back, you know, and at least try to have some sort of coalition. This has not been the same case in the House, in the Senate, because there was this 6-7 year bipartisan working group of Democrats and Republicans. But anyway, I think that that probably is the situation. It's too early, I think, to tell whether this is changing. But I think if capital money comes back again, Bush Democrats would join the majority caucus. You know, it's just politics. It's they want to get reelected. That's what they got to do.
Is the state more conservative than it used to be?
Yeah, I think it probably is.
And why is that?
Well, I'm not sure it was very liberal after statehood or anything like that. I think it probably, you know, the Democrats tended to run things. I mean, you had a sort of an alternation of governors. You had a Democratic governor first, and you had, you know, Wally Hickel had his first term before he got appointed to be the Secretary of the Interior. Then Egan served again, and then Jay Hammond. I think that even Hammond was a fairly liberal Republican. I mean, he was very supportive of the environment and so on and so forth. And then we had Bill Sheffield and then Steve Cooper. I think probably it's getting more conservative because you know, the Republicans are becoming more dominant. I think that the Democrats, although a lot of Democrats will probably, my Democrat friends will probably shoot me when I get out of here, is I think the Democrats, you know, don't have a lot of cohesiveness. You've got, you know, a lot of, you know, Bush Democrats really are, they could be Republicans as much as they could be Democrats, you know. I think that you know, the nation is becoming more conservative, generally speaking, has become much more conservative since the Reagan years, even though we've had, you know, a Democratic president with Bill Clinton, and now, of course, with Barack Obama. But it's becoming much more conservative. I think that the people are not much less willing to spend money on social programs. They're becoming more protective of things like the permanent fund. And they don't want to be involved in experimental things like the Democrats would be and so on. So I think that's probably it. I don't think it's a major sort of conservatism. It's not like Utah or Idaho, but I think it is becoming, it is more conservative. And I think this is also represented in the fact that, you know, Alaska has not voted for a Democratic presidential candidate since 1964, Lyndon Johnson, and it's not, and sometimes it's not even close. In 92, for example, 1992, which was a three-way race between, you know, George Bush Sr., Bill Clinton, and Ross Perot, Bill Clinton came in third. So it can tell you how conservative that was, basically. So I think it is becoming more conservative, but as I say, not, you know, overly conservative, I think, in that regard. But definitely it's always been fiscally conservative, theoretically. In practice, it hasn't really been very fiscally conservative. Because, you know, the difference between the Democrats and the Republicans is the Democrats want to spend money on social programs, the Republicans want to funnel money to the private sector or privatize things. It's not that they don't want to spend money, they just want to spend it in a different way.
How is local government different in Alaska as compared with other
Quite
states?
Quite different, actually. The local government system in Alaska is, you know, largely a product of the state's geography, the large size, and it is quite different from that in the lower 48. In the lower 48, and in Hawaii, of course, so 49 states in the union have their entire physical area included in local government. Most states, of course, is counties, cities, and so on. in Hawaii, it's a kind of county thing. It's a much more streamlined government. In Alaska, when the Constitutional Convention was held in Fairbanks, 55 to 56, there were several incorporated towns in Alaska. You know, Juneau was, Sitka was, and so on. But most of the state was not in any way in a local government system. There were, of course, native villages and, you know, many villages which were established under the Indian Reorganization Act of 1934 and 35. But they weren't, you know, state or under federal, they were under federal control. What happened at the Constitutional Convention is that the founders tried to create a local government system that they thought eventually would cover the whole state. And they developed the borough system, which is kind of like a super county. And they hoped that what would happen is that the mass area of the state would slowly be would slowly develop into boroughs, because, you know, there had to be a sort of a cohesive economic unit, and there had to be revenues that could be raised to run that government. And to cut a long story short, what happened was most parts of the state did not want to incorporate into boroughs. And so in 1963, there was a mandatory borough act that forced many of them to come together as boroughs. And they did, and some other communities have become boroughs since then, largely for economic reasons, you know, so they can levy taxes, like, you know, Aleutians East Borough, which can levy fish taxes and so on. And sometimes they form a borough because they're fearful of another area taking them over and making them pay taxes. The area that was never was at that time not incorporated into boroughs was called and eventually became known as the unorganized borough. In other words, the part of the state that was not organized into boroughs. And the founders originally thought that there would be several of these unorganized boroughs, and so there would be they would be sort of boroughs in training. They were developing a system of government and so on, and developing a tax base to be able to become boroughs. And they assumed or hoped that at one point all the state would be covered by boroughs. I think what they didn't understand is the fact that people don't like to incorporate to pay taxes. So a lot of places won't incorporate because they don't want to pay taxes. And what has happened over the years, of course, is that the state, largely the state, has funded a lot of services in the unorganized borough. For example, 100% it funds education, you know, in the villages and so on. It funds other things 100%. So why would you want to incorporate as a city and start paying taxes if someone else was paying with your cost of your government? It doesn't make sense. And so I think that, you know, it's human nature not to want to do that. So I think that's what's happened. And so there's been a lot of controversy, and there have been a couple of legislators who want, you know, to force areas to organize into boroughs, but it's never come off. And that's probably one of the, probably would say, if most of the founding fathers could come back now, there are very few of them left. Vic Fisher is one of them. That it's probably the thing that they probably would be disappointed about the most, I would figure.
I wanted to talk for a minute about Alaska Natives and okay. Alaska politics. What do you see as the relationship between Alaska Natives and Alaska politics?
Well, the position of the Native community is one of the, you know, local government system is unique in Alaska. The Native community's relationship to the state, I think, in politics is unique, and I think quite different from any other state. The reason for this is, you know, Alaska came late to the Union, and in the 19th century, as you know, in the early 20th century, the policy of the federal government was to assimilate the Native community, and they put them on reservations. And the reservation system is the major way in the south, down south, in the lower 48, that how the federal government dealt with the Native community. And of course, the federal government under the Constitution of the United States has control, as you know, they're in control of the relationship between the federal government, between the nation and the, not the state, okay? So they went on reservations and, you know, there was an attempt to assimilate. Well, on a federal reservation, they're really not involved with state politics. And so, you know, if you go to, you know, states where today Native Americans are in a large, you know, they're a minority, but a large minority, although maybe 8 or 10%. South Dakota, New Mexico, Arizona, Oklahoma, they don't have much influence on state politics because they're largely on reservations. That's changed slightly, as I'll get to in a moment. In Alaska, the reservation system never took root. There are, you know, the reservation down in Metlakatla, and there was an attempt to do that. But by the time Alaska became a state, the United States was going through a period of atonement. They realized what the terrible things had happened to the Native community, the assimilation thing. And so they, you know, the reservation system never took root. So Alaska Natives, most Alaska Natives still live where they lived for, you know, for hundreds of years, generations. So when the state became a state and, you know, gradually started to develop economically, and you started to have various things occur. There was a big settlement, you know, there was a big claim when the pipeline wanted to be built. The Native community claimed that this was going over Aboriginal lands, and there was a fight about this, and, you know, the Secretary of the Interior you know, supported the Native community, and it was a long battle, but eventually the Native community where it was settled in the, you know, in ANCSA, the Alaska Native Claims Settlement Act of 1971, they got 44 million acres of Alaska land, which is about 11%, and they got a settlement of almost $1 billion, actually 962.5 million. And so this began to give them a certain power base. Now, what would have happened in 1890 or 1910, if this had happened, well, you know, the cavalry would have come out, and, you know, that would have been the end of the situation. But by this time, there was this atonement going on. So there was a basis, and, you know, the Native corporations that were set up, the for-profit corporations, you know, now I think account for, I don't, off the top of my head, about 6 or 7% of the Alaska economy. So they were a major force in the state economically. And also, you know, a lot of the Native community that worked through the Native Claim Settlement Act, you know, Emil Nott is a good example, Nels Anderson, other people, they cut their political teeth on that, and then they began to get into state politics and became a very important influence. And there were several of them, you know, Nels Anderson, John Sackett, Frank Ferguson, and of course Al Adams, who was a very influential person until he died in, I think, 2012 or something, 2011. And so the Native community became a force to reckon with. Of course, they were still have a relationship with the federal government and so on, but they were able to, because some of the most skillful politicians in the state, some of the most effective politicians have been Native politicians. And if I were to put on my hand, I have to put on my hand 10 politicians, state politics, who've been, I think 4 or 5 of those would be Native politicians, you know. So they're very, very skillful in that sense. So they've had an impact upon Alaska politics. Now, I would say in the last 10 or 15 years, as many of those people have left or died off, the Native community does not have the influence it once had. There's a couple of them. The other thing that's going to affect the Native community is reapportionment. And, you know, we're having a reapportionment, of course, in 222. We always have one after the descending census, and that could undermine a Native community more. However, the federal government, no doubt, will step in if it becomes too, you know, biased against the Native community. But I think those are the reasons for the Native community being successful, certain politicians, and also, you know, to a large extent, you know, the nature of state politics, and that the whole thing we talked about earlier, that it's very fluid, so the Native community could move on and could play this situation off very, very well, I think. And I think that's part of their success.
On a personal level, did you know early on in your career that studying Alaska politics would be such a big part of your professional life?
No, absolutely not. I'll tell you how I got to the state, what happened, if you want to take a minute to do that. I was teaching, I mean, I got my PhD in Britain, and also I did some courses at George Washington. I worked as an intern in Congress for the House and the Senate. Actually, I worked as an intern for Barry Goldwater, though he never knew who I was. I mean, he had 10 interns working for him. I went to teach at, I came to the United States. I taught at Iowa State. I was teaching at Iowa State. I was married. I got divorced. I was looking for a job. No one would hire me, okay? But I got a call one day from, actually, I did have an interview at the University of New Mexico. And somebody called me from Alaska, and they said, you know, we've had a, you know, because I'd applied for a job there. I'd forgotten I'd applied for a job there. I'd applied for like 20 jobs, and I only got an interview at New Mexico. And I came up here, and I got here, and they said, you know, well, you got to teach Alaska politics. I didn't even know the governor was. I mean, but I took the job because I needed a job, and no one else would offer me a job, you know. And so they said, you've got to teach Alaska politics. And I said, well, could you give me 2 years to find out about it? I taught state politics before. You know, I knew a lot about state politics because I taught it at Iowa State. But I didn't know anything about Alaska politics. And interestingly enough, I'd only been here 3 days. And I go back to my office at the university, which was then called the University of Alaska Juneau. It was called UAJ. And I had a note nailed on my door. And it said, call this number. And it was a 505 number. I knew exactly what it was. University of New Mexico, the first choice, turned it down. They offered me the job. By this time, I'd moved. I wasn't about to move again. So I stayed in Alaska. And over the years, you know, I studied Alaska politics. And one of the things I'd like to say is that people in the state, because no one had really researched Alaska, they were very open to me. I talked to many legislators. I reckon I've talked to 350 to 400 people in Alaska over the years, lobbyists, journalists, legislators, you know, people in local government, and done a lot of work with those people. And that's really what made this book that I've done possible, because I have a lot of, you know, firsthand information by talking to those people. But no, if someone had said this to me, I was going to study this, they would be crazy. And I wouldn't have said it normally. I'm really a Latin Americanist. I got my PhD in American politics and Latin American politics, but I never was able to teach it until about 2002 when I came here and I said, I'm a Latin Americanist. I said, well, we don't want that here. You know, you've got to teach Alaska politics. And that's what I did.
So it took you several years to edit this book. What's up next for you?
I think a long sleep, probably. I'm actually finishing off a book on an introduction to Latin American politics, which I've been working on for maybe 10 years because this took place. I'm actually going to do a little handbook on lobbying Alaska state government. I've taught courses like that for many years and done stuff, and so I'm going to do that. And then I'm actually doing a project in the Balkans on interest groups in the Balkans after the end of the Yugoslav socialist government. So. But those are the things. And once those things are done, I'm going to read novels for the rest of my life, or however long I've got left.
Well, that's all the time we have. We've been chatting with Clive Thomas about his new book. I'm Andrew Kitchenman. Thanks for joining us on Forum at 360.
Forum at 360 comes from Rainbow Foods of Juneau.